yeah, we can say happy holidays, Merry Christmas. I mean, it is on, and we are live here on this Wednesday night. Michigan tonight, that is Thomas Guynes. I'm Dennis Fithian. We're ready to go here. Thomas, how are you? Happy holidays.
Happy holidays to you and yours, D. How's everything going?
It's going pretty good. You know, hoping to get the football game in the Orange Bowl. You know, today there were, you know, they had some of the protocols, and you had the Georgia quarterback and the wide receiver, and then, you know, Michigan getting the boosters. And, you know, I was looking on ESPN, and the seven stories that were on there were all about COVID, all about cancellations. And then, you know, the story with the college football playoff, that there's a possibility that, no, they wouldn't reschedule them. They would, you know, forfeit a game. So, you know, 9 days out, just hoping – of course, hoping for a Michigan win, but, you know, hoping all those guys, it's for many of them, you know, a lifetime dream, you know, to play in a college football playoff. So just hoping that we can get some competition. Everybody stays safe. And, you know, that's the first hurdle. You know what I mean?
Yeah, we definitely got to get to game day, making sure that everybody's, you know, following the necessary protocols, understanding that, you know, these are young men, but yet again, these are still young men. So hopefully the coaches are taking the appropriate actions just to monitor the guys, make sure the guys are staying focused and on track as far as what the main mission is here. Again, having this opportunity, you know, a lot of players go the whole college career not being able to play in this particular environment at this particular time of year. Let's make sure that we're being smart across the board as far as how we're taking care of our bodies, how we're interacting with other people, and making sure that we're keeping these different variants away and allowing us to go in there and have a great game on New Year's Eve and show the world what the Michigan Wolverines are ready to come do.
Yeah, and give a nod to the basketball team. They were able to do it last year, you know, with all the hoopla and everything else. They were able to get their games in. And, you know, the football team, you're right. I echo that. Now, you know, if I didn't start out, you know, that's the big news. I had to talk about that. But, you know, right, you being a former offensive lineman, you know, you always you could have an opinion on, you know, every position out on right. The field. And ultimately, you know, it does come back to offensive line. And, you know, I'll ask you questions about the offensive line. And, you know, this year the offensive line was pretty good. It was so good that, Thomas, that it was the group as a unit was awarded
a unit.
More offensive line award, this big cabinet with a bunch of offensive linemen.
Right.
It's the only trophy that is given to a specific unit in college football, but Michigan won it. You know, and I remember midway through the season, I saw you out at the golf course, and I said, you know, Michigan, I think there were 18 teams at that point. So, I mean, it was,
right,
you were part of a group, and you looked at that and you're like, you know, who votes? We're looking at who votes and everything. I think they give all Division I offensive line coaches a vote, and then they have other, they say, you know, people that are knowledgeable about offensive right. line votes as well. So, I mean, they voted Michigan. So, you know, congratulations to the Michigan offensive unit here, and you as a former offensive lineman. What'd you think of it?
Definitely congrats to the five guys up front and Coach Moore. Definitely have done, you know, a great job this year, especially turning some things around in years past as far as our level of offensive line productivity. You know, the trophy is, if you haven't seen the trophy, ladies and gentlemen, please Google it. It's super dope. It's a one of a kind. It definitely the offensive line. And as I've said time and time again, offensive line is literally the team within the team. And, you know, that symbiotic relationship that we have, those five guys have to have with one another in order to be successful, is paramount and to the overall success of the team. For those that don't know who Joe Moore is, look that guy up. I actually went and him, and, you know, he was the O-line coach at Pitt, at Notre Dame, has definitely produced some stalwarts within the offensive line world to go on and play at the next level. So this guy is very highly regarded in the world of offensive line play. Again, this award is huge. It's huge for recruiting. It's, you know, a nice feather for, you know, these five guys to put in their cap. Personally, and like I said, I've been our offensive line all year. I don't shy away from that because of the fact that I feel like that there's been some inconsistencies within our play. And the reason that given me pause is because I've seen us do really good things up front. But at the same point in time, I've seen us get beat by the same twist. And so when I'm looking at Georgia and I'm looking at what their defensive front seven as a whole brings, not only do they have great individual pass rushers and run stoppers, but they also have a myriad of complex blitzes and twists and stunts that they're going to bring to the forefront. So this award is huge. I salute the guys up front. I salute Coach Moore and the team as a whole. But this right now is going to be a great opportunity for these five guys up front to go out and show the world that we're not a fluke, earned it, and now we're going to prove it to against a highly touted defensive front seven of the Georgia Bulldogs. Because, again, if you've watched any of the Georgia Bulldogs play this season, and I would probably say other than the game, they were completely dominant up front. So it's going to be a huge test for us, but I'm confident that our guys are going to be up to the test, and I'm very interested just to see how we react to it.
Yeah, I'm interested if Michigan, like, you know, you do what you do well, and we know Michigan, if you had to tell somebody that didn't watch this year, well, what's their calling card? You'd say, well, the ground game and big plays. You know, ground and pound, and then, you know, hit them with big plays. That's what Michigan did all year long. You go all the way back to the first game, and you can see it in, if not every game, I think every game, you know, they're hitting big plays, 70-yard plays. My question is, I wonder, heading into this game here, do they say, look, we're going to do what we do best. We're going to go out there, and we're going to see, we're going to give them the, you know, everything we have with the run game. We're going to show them Hassan Haskins. We're going to do what we do, and then – how long, like, so do you think that that's the approach that they're going to take, saying, hey, you know what, we're going to do what we do, and we know what they do, but we're going to see with the first series, the first 10 plays, the first 20 plays, the first quarter? I mean, how do you think they approach it, Thomas, when even if they're talking about it? Like, if I was saying, yeah, we're going to do what you say, yeah, but, you know, let's not try to run in the middle. Like, nobody's had success there. Let's try to do something else.
So I'm a huge proponent of dancing with your date that you brought to the dance, so to speak. But at the same point in time, we need to be, again, have that level of flexibility. Understand what it is that we're going to be going up against. If we go back and you watch the film, very few teams had consistent results or success running the ball between the tackles on the Bulldogs based off of their run bring. Their linebackers are super active. These will come down, punch you in the mouth as well. So, hey, I'm for it. Maybe the first quarter of the first quarter, let's see how we're matching up, see how the boys are doing, see what type of schemes in which they're trying to run. I'm definitely a huge proponent of us not getting too cute with a lot of mechanisms, if you will, as far as with the offensive play calling. Going to have to, again, at some point in time, set a level of dominance to the point where I truly believe that this game is going to come down to the fourth quarter. If we keep it close, if our defense does what our defense has been doing all year, and we're going to need for our offensive line to literally pound and beat these guys up. The Achilles heel, from what I saw, was that, especially in the Bama game, that when Bama's offense started to get a little bit more of momentum, they started leaning on this on the front seven. Their defensive front four wasn't coming as hard. I've said it time and time again all year long. A good offensive, you know, if you got a good offensive line, when you get to the third quarter and you start to see that pass rush slow down, we are going to have to be cognizant of when a guy loops away, keeping your head front side, because everything in which I've seen, they're bringing some level of stunt. I've seen them loop guys around from the defensive right side all the way around to the defensive left side and still. So just because your guy went away, don't get your head stuck in the sand. Keep good body position, keeping your shoulders parallel to the line of scrimmage, and look for something to show back up. And then from there, we have to be active with our feet. The other thing in which I've noticed was that Georgia likes to move in between the snap count. So they'll move as a unit. And at some point in time, they've caused offensive linemen to jump. We can't shoot ourselves in the foot. We can't play behind the chains. Any opportunity that we get to get these first downs, we got to get the first downs. We got to keep the ball movement, the ball moving. But we also have to play on a short field, I believe, as well. If we have to, you know, make 80, 90-yard drives, is going to be a long day for us. All that to be said, this is all very doable. But again, it's going to come down to what is going to be our level of execution, how much attention to detail are we really paying against these guys. When I'm seeing the Bulldogs be successful because of the fact that they've been disruptive in the middle of the offensive line. They're plugging holes. Guys are confused. Again, they're going to bring a lot of intricate stunts and blitzes and twists and games and things of that nature up front. So we have to understand what the looks are. What are we trying to accomplish on offense? But then we have to meet their level of aggression. Us playing Georgia, we're going to be playing a pissed off Georgia team. They lost to Bama in their championship game. Now, to also add fuel to the fire, you have our offensive line winning that award. So as a front seven, okay, you guys are the best offensive line in the country. We're going to show you we're the best defensive front seven in the country. Mono and mono, let the best group win. So I'm super interested and excited to see that. Number 99, their big stud, great talent. Again, his Achilles heel, from what I've seen, doesn't have a great motor all the time. If he has the opportunity to cherry pick and he knows that he's playing against some lesser dans, he's going to have a great day. We have to punch this kid in the mouth, let him know that he's not taking anything from us. Nothing's going to be given to him easily. And if we continue to do that and play with that level of relentlessness and toughness, my prediction is that as the game begins to wear on, we start winning that war of attrition. They start slowing down, and eventually some of our big plays are going to pop.
Yeah, I wonder, Michigan, when it comes to Jordan Davis, it goes 350, 360, whatever it is. Godzilla mostly is there on the early down. So if you know that he's going to be there on the early downs, we throw on the early downs. And, and as you say, if you stay ahead of the chains there, maybe you could run when he's out of the game. That all sounds good. But, I think your point when I'm listening to you here is that, of course, Michigan doesn't want this game to get away from them. They're playing from behind, and, that's going to force them to pass. That's not what got Michigan in the position they are right now. But you know what? As much as Georgia's defense, they've got the speed, and, they're big up front, and, they should be applauded for that. Michigan's defense brings, some level of danger as well. And I think that when you look over at when Georgia has the ball, I mean, their quarterback, I'm not taking anything away from them, say, but the rest of the team's so good. You're always looking for some, whether you want to call it a weak link or, the spot that you can attack. Well, we all know that Michigan has the defensive ends that can get after the quarterback. And, Stetson Bennett, is the kind of QB that, he's not Bryce Young from Alabama. You can get after him. And, Michigan has whether it's a few cards to play, trump cards, however you look at it. Heading into the Ohio State game, I was thinking, if Michigan, if they play their best game, they get it to the fourth quarter, and you come down and just make some plays in the fourth quarter, they've shown the propensity. They've got some players to make some big plays. It's kind of the same path here, at least the way I'm looking at it here for the Orange Bowl. Keep this game close. Michigan's kept the majority of their games. They've been right there at the half. And then, if they can do that against Georgia, get to the fourth quarter, make a couple plays, you can get to the championship game. That's at least, how my recipe for getting to the championship game tonight.
Yeah, I definitely feel like, again, let's get to halftime, keep it close. Whatever close is, if we're down, if we're up, keep it close. Let's keep it manageable. Obviously, that's going to play a big role into psyche and the motivation and the emotional well-being of the team going into halftime. And then now I want to put it on the coaching staff. I want to put it on Harbaugh. I want to put it on his assistants. What is our ability to come in at halftime, making the proper adjustments, looking at the propensity schemes and which the Bulldogs have shown us throughout the first half? Now, what have we found that we can capitalize on? And then from that, go out, capitalize on that. But again, it's going to come down to who wants it more, who's going to execute more, and who makes the least amount of mistakes. We've been really good this year as far as winning the turnover battle. So I think that, again, is going to be paramount in this game, making sure that we don't give the ball away. We have to make sure that we're not getting stupid penalties, false starts, things of that nature, holdings. They're going back watching Georgia. There was a few times where a couple of teams had some really big plays, but they're getting called back for, you know, silly things. Like, you know, holding calls and holding really is you just got to run your feet. We have to be so active with our feet coming up on New Year's Eve as far as within our pass protection and running the ball, because, again, like I said before, this front seven is super active. The linebackers come downhill. They're going to hit you at a lot of different crazy angles with the twists and the stunts and all of the different shenanigans that they like to bring from the defensive front. So we have to keep our head on the swivel, be ready to go hit color, and just run your feet. Now, from the quarterback position, I need for Cade to keep his head on the swivel, obviously looking downfield, but he can't take sacks, right? You can't force it. If it's not there, you throw it out of the end zone. We cannot take sacks because, again, what is that doing? You're demoralizing, you're stopping momentum, and now we're playing behind the chains.
You know, I was looking at some of the numbers today, and there's a couple things to feel good about for Michigan. You know, they get the offensive line award, the Joe Moore offensive line award. Michigan ran the ball the third most times out of Power Five teams, which, you know, speaks for itself. And they had the least amount of plays for loss, which, you know, is what you're talking about, sacks and, you know, getting tackled behind the line, staying in front of the chains. Those are things that look good. And you know, when you just talk about the coaching staff, you know, whatever years passed, wherever the talent level was, the coaching, you know, here, there, you know, Georgia loses their defensive coordinator. But obviously Gattis is he's got to be feeling good about where he's at and the strings that he's pulling and everything that he has in front of him, how he's just been moving the pieces around on the chessboard. And, you know, Mike McDonald, you got to feel pretty good about him too. He's a young guy. He comes from the pros. You know, the Michigan State game, you know what? He got burned. He got burned, whether he thought, you know, it was, you know, in the NFL, the way they change out personnel, you know, it's different. And that's maybe how he got outmaneuvered there by Michigan State, because clearly, you know, the changing and the substitution patterns stated something on tape, and you give him credit for that. But, you know, after that, there's not a spot that you look and say, oh, man, like, you know, this was bad schematically or something else. In fact, you know, he's mixed things up and, you know, the guys seem to play, you know, playing confident and playing loose is, you know, whatever they're actually doing, you know, down there to put the guys in position. I mean, you can see it even as, you know, just taking a look at them. They're playing more confident since then, and it's built. So you got to feel good if you're a Michigan fan from the coaching and the personnel and how it's matched up heading in this.
The one thing I will say that I've noticed this year is our level of developing our players. Years past, you know, we've had 4 and 5 star guys, and for whatever reason, they really just didn't pan out like we thought they were. Again, is that on the player? Is that on the coaching staff that we had at the time and the lack of developing the player, getting them ready to play at the Michigan level? I don't know. But I can say this from what I have seen, and one of the genius moves that Coach Harbaugh has done this year was going out and getting these highly talented, qualified assistant coaches, but they're young guys. Loving the fact that based off of age alone, I'll just go back and talk about the position near and dear to my heart. Obviously, he's going to be the offensive line when I look at Coach Moore, going back and looking at his pedigree and his resume. And this guy, you know, played offensive line. This guy played offensive line at a high level at the University of Oklahoma. So he understands what it is to play at this level. And not only that, but it resonates more, in my opinion, when you got a guy that you know that's been there, done that. Unlike you had an offensive line coach that doesn't look like an offensive line coach. And not only that, but they never really played it, and especially played it at a particular level. Sometimes it's difficult to really allow what they're trying to coach you resonate. You almost take it with a grain of salt. But, you know, my experience has been when I was playing with the Cardinals and we had Coach Carl Mock 12 years in the NFL with the Houston Oilers back in the day when football was football. So when Carl Mack used to, you know, get after you, it is what it was because he's been there, done that. We had Mean Joe Green as our D-line coach at the time. So if you play D-line, again, that's Joe Green, you know, Hall of Famer, several times Super Bowl winner. So what would you not learn from him? So all these things to be said when Coach Harbaugh goes out there and gets to Mike Hart, gets to Ron Bellamy, comes with Coach Moore and the host of others, getting these guys that are young, that are hungry, that the kids can relate to, but they are definitely students of the craft. And so all that to be said has definitely got us and brought us to this particular point right now within the season, as far as us having the type of season that we've had this year. Obviously, you go back and you talk about the Michigan State game. It is what it was. It seems like Sparty lucked up. Obviously, I think most people here, where your allegiance lies, that was a touchdown that Hutch had that got called back. And there's a couple of miscues here and there. And obviously, we had some calls that didn't go the Wolverines' way. But we are here where we're at today. And so our biggest job right now is to remain focused, keep our eye on the prize, and definitely keep these distractions. It's one of the real reasons why I hate this time of year as a player, because you have all these award situations coming out, but there's still football left to be played. So keep your mind, keep your eye on the prize, and let's go out here and get it done against these Georgia Bulldogs.
All right. You know, I was just going to say, you're making me want to go run out. Of course, you make me want to go run at a TV and watch some football. Most nights this week, there have been games on left and right. Not tonight, but it'll be back tomorrow with some Thursday night. Speaking of that, we have 40-some-odd bowls. We've had some played. I watched a little bit of the first half of Eastern Michigan against Liberty this past Saturday, and then I went and watched the Michigan basketball game. But other than that, I haven't really taken in any of the bowls. Starting this Tuesday, I was just looking at the menu, you know, 5 games on Tuesday, 5 games on Wednesday, 5 games on Thursday, and then, of course, Friday, New Year's Eve. So, you know, next week you'll find me doing a lot of bowling, but not till then, really, besides that.
Right.
What about you? I know you work hard. You know, you're not you've got other things to do than, you know, just look at the TV menu for the night. But are there any games that you've circled a little bit or that you want to take in?
I mean, not at this particular point. Obviously, my interests, my thoughts – my energy is going to be for the New Year's Eve game for our beloved Michigan Wolverines. Nothing is really sticking out to me right now as far as must-see TV or must-see bowl games. Honestly, it seems a little watered down these days how they're running the whole system. And, you know, you got the poinsettia bowl and you got the, you know, Cheetos bowl and it's great for the kids. It's great for the kids to get whatever level of that reward is. Obviously, hopefully you're going to play in a sunny state and the weather's nice. You're going to go out and do some things. And it's a wonderful reprieve from whatever your environment is, especially if you're a Midwest school and dealing with the weather that we have up here. But as a purist, you know, bowl games were meant to actually mean something. These were the things in which, you know, you were shooting for to be a part of. And as I sit back and I look at how the landscape has gotten so diluted with these bowl games and all the sponsorships and things of that nature, it kind of takes away some of the prestige of what it means to go to some of these bowl games. Again, happy for the kids. They deserve it. But, you know, I came up in an era where you had a handful of bowls. And these bowls actually meant something. You had a Cotton, a Sugar. I think probably when you looked at some of the lesser bowls of time past, it was like the Peach Bowl or the Blue Bonnet Bowl. But other than that, most of your bowls are pretty much big bowl games, Orange, Sugar, Cotton, obviously the Rose Bowl. So, yeah, I'm just really just waiting to watch these Wolverines go put this work in and come out and play for the national championship.
Well, you could just blame Michigan for that. You know, it was before your time. You know, in the 70s, Michigan had a 3-year run where, you know, they had a tie to Ohio State. And they got, you know, Ohio State got voted in. And, you know, so Michigan's sitting there for 3 years and they lost like one game and tied one game or whatever it was, lost 2 games and tied one. And then finally they're like, we got to, you know, we got to reward these guys. And they sent them to the Orange Bowl, you know, made the Orange Bowl. So here it is. Maybe it's becoming full circle. Thomas, how do you watch the games generally? You like to sit there by yourself, crank up the TV, rewind the plays, or do you watch it with your friends and just watch it straight through? I mean, how do you enjoy, if you're not going to a game, how do you enjoy watching it?
I definitely like watching the game either in the company of good learned individuals, i.e. former teammates or guys that I know actually know what they're talking about, because just being able to bounce ideas and have that discussion as a game is actually being played is definitely a good time for me. I'm not huge into going into the games. I'm not huge in, as far as being in that particular environment, so to speak, as far as actually being in the stadiums, being a larger guy, that stadium seating is not necessarily built for the athletically chunky individuals like myself. So it's, you know, I can sit here in my rocking chair and nod my head. I got whatever my libation of choice is. There's no line at the bathrooms. I don't have to worry about any sketchy foods or any overpriced food. And I'm able to actually watch the game to watch the game. I think a lot of times when you end up being in the atmosphere, you lose track of the game because you get caught up in the hype and just being a part of the atmosphere and that experience. And for some people, that's what they love. Me, as a student of the game, I want to watch the game.
All right, I got a final question for you. If Thomas Guynes could script the first three or four plays for Michigan, what would you run? Knowing the personnel, knowing what Georgia has, are you thinking, hey, let's run Hassan Haskins? Let's, you know, in basketball they always say, let's go right at him. Let's go right at the shot blocker. Is Michigan saying, you know what, let's run it right at Godzilla. Let's see what we've got. Is that going to be that's what I think they're going to do for the first play.
My first or second play would definitely be this. I would probably run a naked boot and get our tight end into some level of open space to keep the chains moving. Let's start the game off with some positives. I don't want to start the game off with no gains or TFL. Let's roll out with a naked boot, move it that way. And hopefully if I get 5 yards and up, I'm happy. Second play, we'll come with a little gap play or whatever dive. Let's test it. Let's mano-a-mano at this particular point in time, because now I'm in front of the count, so to speak. So I have a little wiggle room to play with. So, you know, let's figure out, are we going to run a gap scheme? Are we going to run a zone play? Let's see what these guys are. These guys really that good up front? And then if we're able to make it third and short, or if not get the first down, then we'll sit back and see what our options are at that particular point. There's no need to try to force things just for the sake of forcing it, because this is what we do. I really feel like this is going to be one of those games that you kind of got to test the waters a little bit and then see how the boys are reacting. And if we are taking what they're giving us and we're capitalizing upon that and the boys are doing their thing, unleash the hounds. If not, let's come back to the drawing board and figure something out instead of trying to, you know, keep knocking our heads against a brick wall. If it's not working, stop trying to force it. Let's come up with something else. That's why these guys are making the amount of money which they're making.
Hey, music to my ears, Thomas. Hey, have a great holiday. Thanks so much. Maybe we'll get a chance to talk with you next week before they actually kick it off. Merry Christmas.
Roger that. D, take care. Happy holidays to you and yours.
All right, see you later. There he is, Thomas Guynes.
Take care. Come on.